Hi, a couple of years ago I started getting into D&D. As my passion for D&D grew, so did my collection of minis. And like many others out there, I now have boxes of shame. Legions of unpainted minis. Now this is my underdog story. This is me painting every single one of my miniatures.
Alright, hi guys. So today I was going to paint not one Umber Hulk, not two Umber Hulks, and actually, you know what? I found a total of four Umber Hulks, all from Wizkids, Nolzur's Marvelous Miniatures line. Now, at the same time, I actually got my hands on some metallic color-shifting paint from Green World stuff. So I figured I would try to make sort of a beetle-esque shell for them. And the first step was to use some gloss varnish that I got a tip to use instead of sort of a normal varnish. So I covered my first Umber Hulk with this varnish. And it was kind of thick. And I don't know, I mean, I didn't really like how thick it went on the model. Now here I'm thinking about what color should I choose, because I got like 18 colors, and the first Umber Hulk I decided to go with Evil Forest, which is sort of red-green shifting color, and I used a brush for both the primer and the metallic color, and you know, it went on fairly easy. And you can actually see sort of a shift between black and white primer. The color sort of totally shifts. So this, you have to prime them black. And ideally, a gloss black. Now, this went on fine. But honestly, I think it was during this time when I started, you know, really looking into how the hell do I apply these paints without them being so thickly applied. So, I came up with a solution, simply using the good old airbrush. So, here's my airbrush booth. Doesn't look like much, but I have my three remaining Umber Hulks. And worth noting before this that I've cleaned all of the models as usual. I started out with actually using the primer, which was much, much thinner and easier to sort of get out to a thin layer. And I think I even used a little bit of thinner to actually make it flow a little bit easier. I didn't mind if it would actually dry a little bit faster. But it went fairly smooth just to sort of, and it was much easier. The next Umber Hulk was Nebula Copper, in a sort of, yeah, I guess copper tone towards pink. I find hints of sort of orange and red there as well. And as you can see, this is going on very, very smoothly compared to using the brushes. And it's kind of nice also seeing it building up layer by layer, because this is also a thing, you ideally want thin multiple layers. Now, the next one was a little bit trickier. This was Cobalt Blue, because I figured I wanted my Umber Hulks to actually look different, because I figured, you know what, it could be just as, you know, what hair color do they have. This one went towards sort of a blue-purple-ish. I would have wanted more color shift in it. And the final one was Burning Gold. Now, this one I was a little bit intrigued with, because I wanted each and every one of them to be clearly different, so that my players and me, when we see them on the battlefield, they can easily say, you know, the yellow one, the blue one, the red one. This one I really liked, and I'm probably going to use this for other paints as well. And here you can see all three together. You can clearly differentiate which one is which. Which was nice. But going back to the table after many, many minutes of airbrush cleaning, I think I'm starting to get the hang of it. the first thing I wanted to do was to paint in the fleshy parts. And I used Bugman's Glow from Citadel here, partly because I knew it was a thick color and a very covering color, and I wanted something that could actually sort of cover that metallic sheen that most likely was, you know, on the fleshy bits now. And it actually did a fairly good job of it. So I'm just shifting between the different colors, because if I were to show you each and every one, this would take forever. So you're going to have to just try to keep up. But I try to sort of paint the underside and the sides in a fleshy tone. The next thing I did was to look over the eyes and just sort of give it a flat matte white color for the next step, which was to actually sort of, I wanted the eyes to sort of glow a little bit. So for this I'm using Vallejo inks, which I find is more and more useful the more I use them. So basically after the white is dry, you just sort of drop over some yellow, and depending on how wide you make that yellow, the glow will appear larger. Now, I don't remember if this was a mistake or not, but I figured I wanted the pincers to sort of have a different color to them. So I tried actually using that same yellow ink just to make them pop ever so slightly, but still be metallic. And I did this on all of them. Now, next it was sort of using Reichland Flesh Shade on all of the fleshy bits, pardon the camera angle. This really sort of brought out the shades, and directly after that I went back with Bugman's Glow and sort of tried to hit the highlights. These figures were actually kind of difficult because all of them were hunched over, and I actually had to use some boiled water and make them sort of rise a little bit more because all of them were severely hunched over. And there you can see sort of the result, and this is after Reichland Flesh Shade and another coat, or not a coat, some highlights with Bugman's Glow. And at that point it was time to sort of just give the actual ground, which they're standing on, a little bit of love. So I just use, I think, the closest sort of brown color I had, and then I used actually two tones. I'm only showing the Elder Flesh Citadel dry brush, but also I used another darker, more redder sort of brown. Now, once all of these had dried, I figured I would hit them both with some Agrax Earth Shade, just to sort of darken them down a little bit, which gave me a nice sort of finish. So once all of these had dried, it was time to put them on the base. And I mean, use super glue generally. I personally love, I think they're called Gorilla Glue. It works fast, and yeah, the results are pretty nice. So another thing that I heard was that I was supposed to use a specific varnish ideally. So it's a Vallejo metal varnish. So I pretty much just coated all of the metal parts on all of them. Might have gone a little bit heavy on that one. The reason I didn't use an airbrush was simply I didn't want to have the entire sort of figure, including the terrain or the ground, to also sort of be in this metallic finish. And I think it was a little bit thicker than I was used to, so I was a little bit apprehensive of using the airbrush. So, in order to cover the ground, I just brushed on some matte varnish on the ground. And once that had dried, this is pretty much the result I got. And I have to say, I am really liking the metallic result. It's quite, you know, offensive in your eyes, but it is eye-catching as hell. And I really like some of the colors. So with that, let's have some nice glamour shots, shall we? All right, so as I said, I am fairly happy with these. I managed to pull these four off in, what was it, probably a day, excluding drying times. Do you have similar issues that I have? Boxes of shame? What did you think about the different metallic colors I chose? Were they horrendous or were they amazing? Or somewhere in between? Please comment, please like, share, and you know what? Subscribe. And I hope all of you have a nice day. Toodaloo.